The last speaker in this session is Prof. Tapas Chakraborti from the Indian Association for Cultivation of Science, Calcutta.
Okay, so good afternoon, everybody. I also start thanking Arunan for organizing this meeting and giving us the opportunity to come here and talk about our research. So, two of the must talked about attributes of the hydrogen bonding, the bond energy and the spectral shift of the donor group. Now, in addition to that, there are other attributes which are of course known, but less talked. So, one of them is this intensity. That is, once the hydrogen bond is formed, then this the fundamental, particularly this infrared fundamental of the donor group, in many cases it gains large intensity enhancements. So, just I am starting giving one of this example. Yes, and decreases of course in many cases. So, hydrogen bonding leads up this overtone transitions via these Fermi resonance interactions. So, for this, I take this one examples like this 7 azaindole, which Sanjay already talked about. Now, our experiment is that we try to trap this molecule in this inert gas matrices, argon gas and also in the nitrogen gas, and then record this infrared spectrum both for this isolated molecule and also by annealing this matrix that allows us to form the complex. So, in the controlled annealing allows us to form the complex in a very complex manner, and we can record this how this intensity or any kind of spectral shift also that can change. So, what I am showing here is this matrix isolated spectrum of this 7 azaindole in this argon matrix. Now, see here this, the molecules are isolated here, but still the effect of the environment is very much prominent. Now, if you try to compare this gas phase spectrum with this, although I have not shown here, this region is the region that where the CH fundamentals of this molecule should appear. But you see here that almost nothing is visible. So, it means that this argon matrix, this interaction of this CH group with this argon environment is such that it completely suppresses the transitions. But you can see here the very prominently this NH fundamental that appears, and a spectral shift here, what I have denoted here 3521 is the gas phase NH stretching frequency, and in this argon matrix it is shifted to 3495 centimeter inverse. So, there is a red shift here of this. Now, if you anneal this matrix so that these isolated argon, the 7 azaindole molecules, they can diffuse through the argon matrix and they can form the complex. So, after that annealing this matrix isolation spectrum, it appears like this. So, again this is the NH stretching fundamental of the monomer, but once it forms this kind of cyclic dimer, the spectrum of this NH region, it changes like this. Okay. So, if you try to see here with respect to this background, actually there is a huge enhancement of this intensity, and not only this enhancement of this intensity, these sharp peaks here, sharp lines, these are basically this region is corresponds to many of these overtones and this combination bands of these molecules which are there in the lower frequency region, particularly in the fingerprint range. And not only that, it appears that some of these CH stretching modes which were suppressed when they are isolated, they also gain this intensity. Now, in addition to this argon matrix, we tried to do this experiment same also in the CCl4 solution. If you take this 10 millimolar CCl4 solution, this is the monomer transition and all this dimer, it appears like this. So, difference is that here this matrix is a very rigid environment, temperature is below 10 Kelvin temperature, and this is the room temperature spectrum. Again, if you compare with these things in the supersonic jet expansion spectrum, that where the molecules are again isolated, isolated dimer, almost the same features that this appear. So, if you try to compare, it appears this all these small features that develop over this background, it is medium independent. So, whether it is in the gas phase at low temperature or at room temperature in the liquid phase or in the argon matrix, these features remain independent. Okay. So, this tells in one way is that when this dimer, particularly this cyclic dimer that is produced, this medium that is present in the surroundings, either in the CCl4 molecules in the liquid phase or this argon atoms which surrounding this dimer, they have very little effect on this NH stretching vibrational frequencies. Now, this feature is not this isolated example in the case of this 7 as an indole only. If you take this carboxylic acid dimer, or if you take this any kind of this heterodimer that can form this kind of cyclic double hydrogen bonded network, the behavior is always like this. Now, from this, this example, that is, once you form this cyclic dimer, I just give one more the attributes of this hydrogen bond. The attribute is that once you make this electronic excitation of this kind of cyclic dimeric complex, that electronic excitation in this hydrogen bonded network, it promotes this hydrogen atom movement in this dimeric network, and that can produce from this normal dimer what is called this tautomeric dimer. So I am giving you that kind of example here. So this normal form of the 7 as an indole is like this. Now this dimeric species, it absorbs light around 300 nanometer, and after absorbing this light, there is actually double hydrogen exchange along this double hydrogen bonded interface, and what it can produce is called this tautomeric dimer. Now in the first excited state, or in the excited electronic state, this kind of double hydrogen exchange is actually energetically favorable process. In the ground state, this tautomeric form, although is higher in energy compared to this normal form, but in the excited state, this is lower energy compared to this normal form. So that allows this kind of hydrogen movement. Now here the question is that can be addressed, that what are the different kind of these attributes of the hydrogen bond that can either further promote or even can slow down this kind of hydrogen atom movement. Because one of the criterion for the hydrogen bond formation, as Arunan and the co-workers, they said that this should be about this 180 degree, right? That is the most favorable form of condition. But what I am trying to show here is that this hydrogen atom movement along this line, it also depends on many other coordinates. And possibly one of the requirement is that there must be large amplitude motion along this hydrogen bonded interface. Because if that large amplitude motion is hindered, then even under this favorable geometry, under electronic excitation, this kind of hydrogen atom movement can be restricted. So that is what I am going to show here. Now, this is again what I am trying to say here, that this kind of motion, it is not an isolated example for this kind of homodimer of 7 as an indole. This happens in the kind of mixed dimer like 7 as an indole of acid and this alcohol complexes. We have tried to see that this 7 as an indole, when you make a complex with kind of amides, whether it is linear amide or cyclic amide, in everywhere the same situation happens. The experimental manifestation of this occurrence is that when the molecules are isolated, or if you take a very dilute solution and excite here, it gives this monomer emission that is in the ultraviolet range. But once the dimer is produced, in the electronic spectrum, there is a kind of redshifting here. And if you excite somewhere here, you get only this redshifted tautomer fluorescence, or this green fluorescence. So this observation of the green fluorescence is the experimental manifestation for occurrence of this kind of hydrogen atom movement and production of the tautomers in the excited state. Now again, what I try to say is that this is not only under room temperature, but the same phenomena also occurs under the cooled environment of the supersonic jet expansion, and that was demonstrated long back in the 205. Now this is the situation once you try to do the same thing in the argon matrix, because I already have shown before that if you look at this infrared spectrum, the spectrum of this dimer under the argon matrix same as that of the liquid phase and also in the supersonic jet expansion, so that ensures that this cyclic dimer has been produced. Now again, when the molecules are isolated, and if you excite this isolated molecule, this is the emission spectrum. Isolated molecule absorbs like 290 nanometer. If you excite the molecule, this is the normal fluorescence, and at that low temperature, that is below 10 Kelvin temperature, there is a strong phosphorescence of the molecule also. If you under the situation, if you excite the dimer region, this is the emission spectrum, because it means that the dimer has not been produced unless you anneal the matrix. So it means this spectrum has been recorded immediately after deposition of the matrix when all the molecules are isolated inside the argon matrix. Now if you allow the matrix to anneal and the dimer formation occurs, under that situation, if you make this electronic excitation, if you make this monomer region 290 nanometer, you get again this monomer type of emission. But once you excite this dimer emission, like a position 310 nanometer, we do not get any this kind of your tautomer fluorescence. Only thing that we get is this normal fluorescence of the dimer. So these I can compare the emission spectrum when you excite at the same position, but in the at room temperature, in the liquid phase, either in the CCl4 or in the hydrocarbon. So it tells very clearly that although you have produced a cyclic doubly hydrogen bonded dimer and excite the dimer band, but if you do not allow the molecules to move, if the movement is restricted by the medium, this kind of tautomerization process, this chemical transformation that is also restricted. And one of the explanation that I try to suggest is that since this tautomer position in the excited state is lower in energy compared to this, so the density of state at this region is quite large. So this density of state is contributed by many of these large amplitude and low frequency modes, but all of them are restricted once they are in the argon environment. So it's basically this irreversible transfer from this region to this region is basically restricted. So this doesn't happen. Now I would like to tell one more thing, that this kind of cyclic dimer, it is not only that in the hydrogen bonded interface, but we produced also in the supersonic jet expansion. So these are the examples, like taking this 7 as I told, we produced this cyclic dimer with many linear amides and also in the cyclic amides. And as long as those amides, these dimeric amides, mixed dimer, they are at room temperature in the liquid phase, all of them, they give this kind of green fluorescence, this tautomeric fluorescence. And same thing is also happens with the carboxylic acids and also with the alcohols. But once we cool them under the supersonic jet expansion, this tautomerization process in every case are restricted. We do not see anywhere. Only thing that we can see is this blue shifted emission. So this is the summary. That is, this is an example of the 7 as I told, and an amide with, that is called this, this is a 7-membered amide. And if you look at this electronic spectrum, this is fluorescence excitation spectrum under the supersonic jet expansion. This is the monomer band of this dimeric complex. These are some of these low frequency modes. And if you record the same fluorescence excitation spectrum, probing only the local emission, this excitation spectrum are the same. But if we record this green emission, basically everything is absent here. So this tells very clearly that this kind of dimeric, mixed dimeric complexes, they do not undergo at all this tautomeric transformation. Now the cyclic dimer has been produced. The difference from this homodimer and this mixed dimers are that the hydrogen bonds are not truly linear. There is some kind of nonlinearities are there. So that kind of nonlinearity at that low temperature, that doesn't allow this kind of proton exchange to take place. But the same complexes, when they are taken at the room temperature in the liquid phase, this kind of proton exchange, it becomes almost irreversible process in one direction. Now from there I go to some kind of other attributes. Let me just, because there will be some restricted of the time. Hydrogen bonding promotes this hydrogen atom release from this molecular ion. This will be the last example. The system that you have taken is this phenol. Now the experiment is the following, that if you make these phenols photoionized, because this phenol the resonance absorption is around 4.5 electron volt. So if you shine light on phenol of wavelength about 266 nanometer, it makes an excitation from the ground state to first excited state. If the molecule absorbs two photon, basically it exceeds this ionization energy, so you can produce this phenol ion. Now this phenol ions, once it absorbs these two photon, it is basically produced with about this 18 kilocalorie per mole excess vibrational energy. So this vibrational energy can help this phenol ion to undergo or to open up many kind of chemical reactions. So one of this reaction is that from this photoionized phenol cation, it can release this proton, or it can release the hydrogen atom, or it can also undergo this fragmentation. So what we have done, that we have done this experiment again under the supersonic jet expansion condition, so that a series of this kind of monomer and these different complexes can be produced, and all of them, they are the photoionized by exciting about 10 millimeter downstream of this nozzle. So observation is the following. If the concentration is very low, so that the dimer formation is restricted, and under that situation, if you photoionize the phenol, then only reaction that happens is the following, that from this phenol monomer, we can see that there is a carbon monoxide release, and then there are some others, of course, the ring the breaking, and we get this kind of fragments. But here, this one particular reaction is that from this phenol cation, whether it can release the hydrogen atom, so that this hydrogen atom subtracted, the cation can be observed. It appears that this peak intensity is very small here. It means that as long the molecule is under the isolated, this hydrogen atom released from this phenol cation, the reaction does not happen. But on the other hand, and this of course can be understood partly looking at this energetic situation, because from this phenol cation, the release of a proton is very much endothermic. Same as also, if the hydrogen atom released from this phenol cation, also it needs about 3.9 electron volt energy. Our this resolution of our mass spectrometer is sensitive enough, because if any proton is released, we could have observed here, because that we have seen in the case of this other system. Now, under the complex formation condition, that is when the concentration is relatively larger, and the backing pressure of the helium is also larger, so that large amount of complexes can be produced. So this is the mass spectrum. This is the monomer of the phenol cation. This is the dimer, trimer, tetramer, pentamer, and so on. If you look at this dimer region here at a expanded scale, immediately you see that unlike this proton position, this is the dimer peak, and this phenol dimer is a hydrogen bonded dimer that has been photoionized, and here is actually a hydrogen atom release peak, and this peak, it means that from this phenol dimer, two hydrogen atoms are released. So if you compare these things with the monomer, as long this phenol is the monomer, the hydrogen atom release from the phenol cation is practically restricted. But once it forms a hydrogen bonded dimer, immediately that channel becomes very much prominent. So it is showing an example that this hydrogen bonding, it can promote this some kind of reaction channels even under this isolated condition of the molecules. And of course, that we have tried to understand that whether in terms of this energetics that can be understood, it appears that it depends that how after this hydrogen atom release, this rest of the part of the molecules, what is the geometry of this rest of the part. See, if the hydrogen atom is somewhere here that is shared by these two oxygen atoms, it appears this energetically it is not that much favorable. But on the other hand, if there are other possible reactions like this, that this one of this phenol, this oxygen atom, if it is bound at the para position of this other phenol group, then possibly this energetically it becomes favorable. If the two hydrogen atoms release, then possibly this kind of compound can be produced, which is less energy demanding, and of course some other reaction channels we have proposed, so that this occurrence of this reaction can be understood. One way to understand is that if we substitute this block, this phenol position, then what can happen? So this is what we have done. If we take this parafluorophenol and do the same experiment, it appears that from here, one hydrogen atom release from this parafluorophenol cation is favorable, but unlike phenol, this two hydrogen atom release is completely restricted here. So it appears that some kind of product where involves this paraposition of this phenol is involved in the formation of the chemical reaction. And one of the reason for suggesting that kind of reaction channel is that long before, it is about 1990, this Bruch's group made this kind of one of the suggestion is that when they took this benzene and amine complexes and made the photoionized, they generated this aniline. So it means that photoionized aromatic molecule, they can chemically react with this nitrogen atom and form this kind of covalent bond. So it means that same thing can also happen under this situation when there is a dimer phenol complex. Other situation that I want to tell is that once you make this phenol electronically excited phenol, even from this S1 state, this hydrogen atom release, this is one of the non-radiative relaxation channels, and that happens because of these two conical intersections of this first excited state of the phenol with this kind of repulsive state with respect to OH hydrogen bond. So, one of the possibilities is that when the dimer is electronically excited here, after this electronic excitation of the dimer, since they are hydrogen bonded, so this kind of hydrogen release from this hydrogen bonded dimer, very similar the way that this hydrogen atom usually can transfer under this Grotthus mechanism. So, that becomes almost a flat potential, and the rest of the system can be photoionized by the second photon absorption. That also could be a possibility. Okay, and finally, I want to show again in the same direction a chemical reaction. The chemical reaction is the following, that if you take an orthofluorophenol and this metafluorophenol, if orthofluorophenol is photoionized, then the possibility is that along with this hydrogen atom released, it can take a fluorine atom. So, it means that instead of only hydrogen atom released, there could be HF release. That could be one of the reaction channels. And of course, that would be blocked completely if we take this metafluorophenol, because the fluorine atom is far away from the hydrogen atom. So, here this objective is again the same, that if you allow this dimeric complex to produce, because here it is an electron hydrogen bond acceptor group, hydrogen bond donor group. So, whether this kind of reaction channel can be enhanced again by the formation of hydrogen bonded network. So, the reaction approach is the same, that we have photoionized these molecules both for as a monomer and also the dimeric complex, and then try to see that what are the different reaction channels. When the orthofluorophenol is taken, you see here this small amount of hydrogen fluoride has been released from this monomer cation, and the other reaction channel is of course carbon monoxide as well as this hydrogen fluoride HF release. But if you take here this metafluorophenol, only reaction channel is the carbon monoxide release. There is no HF release channel because fluorine is far away from this hydrogen atom. Okay? And being this fluorine is somewhat much closer spatially compared to this hydrogen atom, fluorine HF release becomes still a smaller reaction channel. But if you look at this dimer channel, again I am just, then what happens? Once the dimer is produced here, this is the dimer peak. And this HF release in the case of the dimer is so large that we do not get any intact dimer cation here. Only thing that is got is this HF release dimer peak. And in the case of this metafluorophenol, where the molecule is monomer, no HF release occurs. Now, this HF release channel is basically opened up. So, what we see here in this case, both this dimer, intact dimer of this metafluorophenol, from this intact dimer one hydrogen atom has been released, and again this HF released dimer peak that opens up. So, it tells very clearly that how, because of this hydrogen bond formation, even in the case of this dimeric system, this new reaction channel can be opened up. And then of course, we have done some kind of this electronic structure calculation, then how, that what are the possible probable geometry of this, because since they are the two donor and acceptor groups are there very nearby. So, it is likely that there should be a doubly hydrogen bond type of cyclic network, that is the most favorable geometry in the ground state. And then because of this electronic photoionization, that is how this geometry can be changed, and this favorable reaction channel could be favored. So, in the case of this orthofluorophenol, we see that indeed this product formation and hydrogen bonded release becomes energetically favorable. But it is of course not that much favorable in the case of metafluorophenol, although it is, if we just consider a particular reaction channel, it becomes favorable. So, this is how we try to explain these things. I stop here. So, these are the students, both of them have got the PhD degree who contributed to these projects, and I thank you all for listening.
Hi, that was a lot of work. Just one question. You said that you don't see the tautomerization in the cold beam and in matrices, but yeah, you see that in solution. Have you ruled out the activation barrier being overcome at room temperature by just thermal energy?
See, since it occurs in the, under this supersonic jet expansion condition, in the case of the doubly hydrogen bonded dimer, so generally belief is that this hydrogen atom transfer is actually barrierless process, like in many cases. But
you said in the, it doesn't happen in the jet.
Right. But once we take this mixed dimer, at room temperature thermal energy, available thermal energy is nearly about 200 centimeter inverse or something like that at 300 Kelvin temperature. But this mixed dimer, we put about 1000 centimeter inverse excess vibrational energy, but still we did not see any occurrence of any kind of hydrogen atom exchange.
It's not a thermal.
No, it's not happening in the excited state.
Other question I had, if I can, in the matrix, why did you have such a broad peaks in the dimer? The breadth of the spectrum in the argon matrix was huge.
Yes.
Why is that? After annealing, again you cool it back down.
Yeah, yeah, I'm just coming back.
Why is it so broad?
Yeah. Even this one, right?
Yeah.
Well, so that's what actually I'm trying to say here, is that if you look at this width here, this width, unlike this gas phase, the width is about our estimated width in argon matrix, although the temperature is about 7 Kelvin temperature, is about 7 to 8 Webb number. Whereas in the gas phase, even at room temperature, is about 3 Webb number. So there is certainly this interaction with this matrix, even at this temperature, is broadening these things.
Not
now the width, what
the green the, one.
This width, actually what I am trying to say here is that this intensity enhancement is so large. There's all this kind of weak transitions here that is coming from there, because there are actually about 100 possibilities are there because of the combination and this overtones. Density of states is very large here at this frequency range here. So
but
all of them are basically
CCl4 it would have been broadened much more. Solution.
That is exactly same thing is happening
solution.
Here. If you look at here from here to here, it's almost it's very large. It's CCl4 is relatively more red-shifted compared to argon matrix. But the width is almost similar. And same thing is also in the gas phase. It is not as small under the supersonic jet expansion condition.
So in this double hydrogen transfer reaction, the excited state, you said the tautomer is around 7 kilocalorie more stable.
Yeah? Yes.
So that is, but when the double hydrogen transfer occurs, you lose the aromaticity of the
rings. No, that is much more stable only in the excited state, not in the ground.
Yeah,
state.
So how do we actually, you know, describe the higher stability of the tautomer in the excited state? Is it because of some other, you know, electronic features?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
The question is regarding the same, the broadness of the peaks. What is the concentration of the 7 azine dole in argon matrix in the dimer?
Okay, so initially it's very difficult to estimate the exact concentration. So what we do that we start from a situation where the in the matrix the molecules are fully isolated. So this is the situation. Then slowly we anneal them.
Okay.
Okay. So once you try to anneal it, suppose initial temperature is about 8 Kelvin temperature. So you see that once the temperature is raised from 8 Kelvin to about 15 Kelvin, immediately the molecular movement within the solid argon matrix starts. And this peak intensity, it grows. But we see that even from 15 Kelvin to we go to 30 Kelvin temperature, this band shape remains independent.
I was just wondering whether this broad peak is because of excessive
larger cluster or not, right?
Yeah, concentration.
Yeah, we don't think so.
I mean the CH stretches are coming up, whereas CH is not even involved in now.
No, the reason is that what I'm saying that it is not from this larger cluster, because the shape remains independent irrespective of this intensity enhancement.
Okay. And what about the NH shift, since NH is forming a hydrogen bonding interaction?
Yes, so this is actually quite large shift. So if you look at here, this from 3495.
Yeah.
To this mid position somewhere is about the 32 centimeter inverse, so very large shift.
Okay, and what about those small peaks, the green colored spectrum in between?
You mean this here?
No,
in between, I was going to ask you.
Oh,
about
this
it.
In between?
Yeah.
Oh no, this is because this is what we explained, because in this argon matrix, unlike this gas phase, When the two molecules is coming closer, it is not necessary that all the time they should be forming hydrogen bonding, a head-on type of complex. Mm-hmm. Some cases the single hydrogen bonded complex are also produced. So these are the signatures of the single hydrogen bonded complex, because this is absent in the case of this gas phase.
You seem to be having some hint in the monomer.
Which one?
The same reason, there yes. seems to be some hint in the whatever you call as monomer.
But we have assigning this thing, this is the single hydrogen bonded dimer.
Okay.
Because this is a rigid environment.
Thank you.
Let's thank Tapas again for a good talk.